Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us once again on another episode of ListenABLE. To the people who keep referencing as ListenABLE, we appreciate it, but it is ListenABLE.
Yeah, I actually get asked that a bit. Yeah. I love your podcast, ListenABLE. Yeah, and we're like, ListenABLE. They're like, oh my God, that's really witty.
That makes sense.
It makes sense. And we feel good about ourselves. So many people putting up our stuff online as well, which we really love. It really helps get our podcast in more people's ears. And we've got a young legend coming on today who's going to share their story.
Let's let them introduce themselves.
Hey guys, thanks for having me today. My name's Alex Noble and I'm 18, turning 19 in July. A young male, first year university, loves a bit of footy, and yeah, it's pretty much all me. Love a bit of a party.
Hang on, before we get into the party and the disability, when you say footy, what are we talking? What kind of footy?
Oh, I played touch footy, rugby union, rugby league.
The wrong kind, if you ask us.
Yeah, you're a New South Wales boy, obviously, or Queensland.
Yeah, I like
yeah.
it.
And, oh, you think AFL?
Yeah, we're AFL vlogs, that's God's for gift. Sure. Alex, what's your disability?
So I'm a C4-5 quadriplegic. I broke my neck playing rugby union sevens in 2018. And yeah, so I'm incomplete C4-5 quadriplegic. So I have a bit of movement from my shoulders down, a bit of movement in my legs, or a tiny bit. And yeah, in my arms a little bit here and there.
So you're still a fan of the sport that put you in a wheelchair?
Yes, definitely.
Okay. Good to hear, actually.
I love that. Did you have a moment, was there times when you weren't a fan?
I think the first couple games back after my injury, I started watching. I still loved it, but it was just hard, or not harder to watch. Just every time someone got tackled, I was like, ooh. Like, yeah. But I'm a bit more used to it now.
It's interesting because was it more difficult to watch the game that you should have been playing or would have been playing in rather than watching the NRL on Fox Sports or anything?
I think watching my brothers play and my mates play, I'm a bit more worried. Like I'm on the sideline and every time someone gets tackled, I'm like, oh, yeah, it's a bit, how you going? Yeah. And there's so many tackles that are so much worse than mine. And I'm like, how do you not get injured there?
But it's a game of inches, literally, when it comes to the damage you can do literally, to your spinal cord, apparently.
Nice line. Thank you very much. That's some good content by you. Now, Alex, we're going to talk about the day that you had an accident and what that meant for you. But before that, were you any good? How'd you get into sport? Or what kind of kid were you as well?
I was definitely an athletic kid who was very dedicated to sport. My whole life was pretty much sport. Like, I didn't do anything other than sport, pretty much. I played rugby my whole life. I played soccer when I was younger, like 5 years old to about 10. And then mum finally let me play rugby union when I was 10 because I went to St. Ignatius College, which is a rugby sport. So mum finally let me play. And yeah, I was definitely just an athletic kid, full of energy, love playing footy.
So take us to the day that you played rugby for the last time.
Able-bodied rugby for the last time.
Oh, good point.
Could be still a chance.
So it was Sunday morning. Normal Sunday morning, and I was on my L's, got in the car to go drive to New South Wales Sevens training, which was at Knox College. It was about like 8 o'clock in the morning. We started training probably 8:30, and then about halfway through the training session, we started playing an opposed session, so 7v7, just against a friendly against our team. And I had the rugby ball in my hand, and I kind of tried to goose step the opposition and get around him while palming him.
What's a goose step for people that don't know?
A goose step. So, it's a bit hard to explain, but it's like a step, but you pretty much slow your acceleration down and then quickly accelerate again. So you kind of stumble
it's like
the opposition.
Someone out.
It's a fake out. Yeah, mate, you nailed it. Perfect explanation.
Yeah. So, and while I was doing that, I tried to palm him, and as I did that, he grabbed my arm and pulled me straight down, which kind of flipped me over onto my head. And then I'm not sure what happened from there. I think my body went over my head or something. And then, yeah, I just lied on the floor and couldn't move anything at all other than my eyes, pretty much.
So you're not the first rugby player that we've actually interviewed on the podcast who's now paraplegic or quadriplegic because of rugby, specifically as a sport. With more research and awareness as well that goes into CTE, for people who might not know what that is as well, you might have seen Concussion, the movie with Will Smith. It's basically progressive and fatal brain disease from repetition of hits. Do you think more needs to be done about the prevention of accidents in the sport now that you're on this side of the fence?
I've had a couple of questions like this. I think there's definitely been a lot of improvements, obviously, with keeping safety in sports, especially rugby. I think they're doing a pretty good job now. I wouldn't say there needs to be any more. I reckon it's, there probably could be some specific stuff still, like developing something like with head injuries. But I think they've been very precautionous, like the HIA and making sure, obviously heaps more penalties now. Some would say the game's getting too soft, I reckon. But I think they're doing a good job.
Okay.
So you pulled down, someone pulled on your arm when you're trying to hand them off.
Call it a chicken wing or pretty much close to that kind of
And then
of
pulled on your head and you flipped over, or so you landed forward first into the ground. Is that right?
It was kind of all a blur, to be honest. But I remember he just grabbed my arm, pulled me down, and I think my arms were like by my side, so I hit my head first.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then my body flipped, must have flipped over.
You're lying there on the ground. Only your eyes work, as you put it. What's going through your head, man?
The first thing I thought, because I was in year 10 and I was trialing for Opens Rugby at Riverview, so which is like 11 in year 12. And the first thing, and there was trials the next day on the Monday, like a fitness test. And the first thing I thought to myself was, am I going to be able to train tomorrow?
Yeah.
Because I've been training my whole life for that, pretty much that moment. So that was my first thought. And then I don't think I realized the extent of the injury when it happened, but I think the trainers did. I was just so confused because I couldn't feel anything. Like, I thought my leg was in the air, but then it was laying down in front of me. And then I thought my arms was like above my head, but then I saw with my eyes, it was like beside me. I'm like, something's going wrong here. Mm. I was just so confused.
It's so funny. The first thing that comes into your head, I had an accident in 2012 before the London Paralympics where I was holding a glass in my hand and somebody picked me up the back of my chair and I landed on the glass and I severed my ulna nerve, tendon and artery in my hand. That's why I played tennis in the quad classification, because half my hand doesn't work. And first thing I thought was, what about training tomorrow? And the guy's like, probably would have thought, hey, I'm going to bleed out and die here, because that's what was happening. But yeah. You just don't even think, like, when you have a big accident like that, I think it hits you so quickly. Can you remember what it was like when you, like, when did you start to come to terms with what might have actually happened to you?
I think even during ICU, I was in intensive care for 8 days. And I think even still then, I was just confused. When I look back, it was all a blur. I don't know if it was the drugs or something like that, but I'm pretty sure mainly when I started doing physio, I think, at North Shore Hospital in like the spinal unit, I think that's when I realized that, yeah, this could be permanent, eh? And yeah, now I've come to terms with it.
For a guy who's maybe setting his sights on a career in sport and immediately in the blink of an eye, it's over. How do you, is that a process to mentally overcome? I mean, obviously you've got so many physical battles that you're about to face, but how are your mental ones?
I think initially I had my whole life I was my whole life was focused on playing sport in the future, playing rugby, being an NRL star or whatever. And then that literally all got taken away from me. And then, I thought my life would like crumbled, to be honest, but I saw the support surrounding me. Like, I got so much love surrounding me that came to hospital like every day, brought me food. And I thought I can't let this define me now. I'm going to have to dominate the world somehow else and be the best of me in another way. So I think I did very well to adapt to the situation and shift my focus from like physical to mental and like apply myself in my studies. So I pretty much pivoted all my focus to a different direction really well, I think.
Of course, the accident affects your life greatly and will always be, who you are today. What about, there's someone else who is affected apart from your family, and that's the person who laid that tackle on you. Have you ever had a conversation with that guy? Because I'm sure after the accident, finding out the diagnosis that you're a quadriplegic, he would have been pretty distraught himself, I imagine. Or maybe that's not the case.
Yeah, I've talked to him a couple of times. He brought me a hash brown when I was at North Shore. So
it couldn't be a better gift, to be honest.
Yeah, so we're pretty even now, I reckon.
2021 Olive Branch. Yep.
But yeah, I feel bad for him. Like, it was not his fault at all whatsoever. The tackle wasn't even bad, but yeah, so both of our lives will probably change forever. But yeah,
I just wonder if he would ever hit a tackle as hard as he ever would, whether you would continue playing rugby.
Does he still play rugby?
I think so, yes.
Mm. I just wonder, I don't think I could ever hit a tackle as hard as he would.
It's interesting. It was the cricketer, Phil Hughes, who passed away while he was playing, and the guy bowling at him with his mate, Sean Abbott, I believe, and he still plays, which is good, I think, because obviously it was
a freak accident.
Wasn't intentional, yeah.
Freak accident. Yeah.
Do you want to have a beer with that guy? Or do you just move on with your new life?
I don't not like him. It's just I think it'll be very awkward.
Yeah.
Mm. Fair
enough. Well, guess what? He's here today with us. No, he's not actually. Just kidding. I was just going to say one thing. We're talking like, by the way, you're so well spoken for a young guy. I don't even remember if you said your age at the start.
18.
But we're talking like this is 10 years ago. This was like 2 years ago.
Yeah. I remember you sent me a video.
I know. I was watching that video before I came in. Very nice of you. You put it on social media. You didn't have to do that. That was just a little message that I sent you. And I remember I was actually going through your Instagram, man, at @IFightYouFight. I want to know what that means first. Better watch out, Angus. Almost got as many followers as you. He's like up on the 30,000. But one thing that I love about your Instagram, which I want to touch on now before we find out what that means, is, man, you smashed your rehab, man, when you first had an accident. Was that on purpose? And can you talk about what were some of the things that you did?
Well, when I was in ICU, I knew it was going to be a long road. Like, I knew something terrible happened to me and it's going to be a long road to recover. So I didn't really set big goals in the future, whereas I set small goals, which will hopefully those goals will accumulate and bring me to that greater goal. But if I looked at the big goal of just big goal in the future, I would have been overwhelmed and I would never have made it. So I kind of put just small goals, like slowly working towards just gym as like one or two times a day, physio every day, and just train as hard as I could there. And then the next day do it again and just be persistent with it. And then, yeah, just train as hard as I could so I could be the best I could, I guess.
I love that.
Was there any sort of hope that you would get some sort of more mobility back in working harder in the gym to try and do your physio?
By the looks of it, you have, bro.
Mm.
Yeah, definitely. I'm pretty sure the doctor said, like, because C4-5 is, well, C4, you have no biceps, I don't believe.
Yeah, can you actually explain that? Because I didn't want to bring that up because you're rolling through. I don't know, is C1 the very top of my spine that goes down in like a numbered order?
Yeah, so it starts at C1 and it goes down to C7 and then it goes into T's, I believe.
Correct.
To T12 and then L1, L2, I'm pretty sure.
Well, he knows his spine. That's exactly right. So the C is cervical, T thoracic, L is the lumbar. So I'm like a T5, T6 is where my injury.
Yep.
Which starts.
Is below your nipples.
Yeah, pretty much. I've got to think like a corticeric in my spinal cord, which is like a patch of fluid. That's my first damage. And then I'm a weird unit because my tumor grew from into T and L. So I'm like all down there. Does that make sense? Right. So it's all messed up.
Yep.
Weird unit because of my back and just a human as well.
And so for you, C4-5, that's pretty high up. Maybe like, is that neck-ish down? Like, you know, Adam's apple down? Something like that?
Yeah, about Adam's apple, yeah. So I got like a scar from like in my like hair nearly my shoulder blades. So C4-5, so it's C1, C2, and then C3, and then I'm C4-5, so a bit of both. So yeah, it's pretty high up. Pretty sure C1's like no diaphragm as well as C2. C3 is nothing but shoulders. C4, pretty sure just shoulders as well. Like just
with
traps.
A tiny bit of others, yeah.
And then C5 is when you get a bit of biceps. And yeah, that's what I have, set a bit of biceps, but my left one's actually pretty strong. My right one's not so strong. And yeah, it's literally inches makes your life so different. If I was 1 inch up, I would not be able to move my arms at all. And if I was 1 inch down, I'd have so much more. So yeah, it's very weird. And
that's so interesting.
Is your left bicep bigger, like Rafael Nadal style? Like he only does bicep curls on one side?
Yeah, literally.
So in terms of like that movement, I mean, just we have a lot of people with disability who listen, but also, you know, majority of able people learning. If you don't do that rehab initially, right, it's so hard to get it back. Is that right?
Yeah, I think as soon as you have your injury, the aim or the doctors and the physios told me the sooner you get back into it and the quicker the recovery or the greater your recovery will be. So as soon as I heard that, I was like, I may as well just go nuts now.
Yeah.
And then I kind of haven't stopped. I've just been keep going.
And you can see how hard it is for people, right, that have an accident, your life's turned upside down. And then if they sook it for a while, you've missed your moment to do your rehab.
You know, is that rude to say if you sook it for a while?
No, that's what I'm saying. Could you imagine how hard it is for people? So
I wouldn't, you know, I just want to grieve what my life used to be.
But if you're like, you don't have time. Because if you grieve,
okay,
you lose that window that you get to rehab, right? And that's why rehab centers are so hard. It's hard places, man. I mean, you've been in one because there are so many different, I guess it was so refreshing to hear you say it's a mental battle, right? Because if you can mentally get yourself out of bed every day to do that, it really benefits your life in the long term.
Yeah, 100%. And I think you have to shift from physical because you've lost all your muscles. So you got to shift to mental. I reckon being mentally strong is way more powerful than being physically strong anyways.
So you're getting this movement back. You hit your window hard, and you can see that on your Instagram as well. It's great to see. But you're 18 years old. You're turning 19 July. So you're 18. You probably had ideas of, you know, you're studying uni, but moving out of home and stuff like that, you would be, I imagine I'm asking a question as an able-bodied guy, like, is there a daily reminder of your disability and another obstacle to overcome mentally? Because you might see your mates that finally get approved for a rental and you're probably going to have to stay with mum and dad for a little longer, stuff like that.
I try not to compare myself to other people and just focus on what I can do and what I can change, because if I can't change something, there's no point focusing on it really. So just ignore it and be the best I can.
What about independence? I mean, you're only 2 years since accident, but are you fully independent, semi-independent? How are you cruising around?
No, I still require a lot of care. So I have a carer that comes in the morning, helps get me up. And then also at nighttime. Nighttime's really quick, just getting into bed.
Yep.
And then I can function like a laptop and everything by myself. It's just I can eat by myself. I can brush my teeth by myself. But yeah, it's mainly just the initial bit in the morning and getting into bed at night. But there's still other things like getting food out of the fridge I struggle with and all those little things. But yeah, my main goal, one of my main goals was to achieve greater independence. Straight from the start and still ongoing. So yeah.
Good on you, bros.
Electric wheelchair?
I do have electric wheelchair, but I haven't been in that for like 9 months. No.
Mate, he's rolling the manual, baby, which I'm impressed about, bro.
The power chair is good creation, but I just hate it.
Fair call. People say to me, wouldn't you use a power chair? And I'm like, because I would be so fat. Imagine if we weren't exercising and things like that. You know, obviously for people that need them, but if you have the opportunity to manual, I think a lot of people like to try at least. How'd your mates react, brother, when you had your accident?
Oh, they were awesome. Like, I wouldn't be who I am or where I am today without my mates and family. Obviously some left, like some I'm not friends with anymore, but I think I've grown closer to a lot more, which is more important. And yeah, they've just been heaps supportive, taking me up millions of flights of stairs, helping me get out and about to places, going to parties, Not just a party man, by the way. Like,
you, sound like all. You sound like
you're
a party
18
man.
Years old. You're allowed to have a beer, mate.
Yeah, I'm 18. But yeah, I try to stay off the drink, but I still go to parties sober, which is good.
Yeah.
So for people who might be listening, who've got a friend who's had an accident, or maybe in the future they're going to have an accident. Like, for one, I know how to do CPR in the hope I never have to use it. But the point of it is, if someone's listening right now and they can learn something about being a supportive friend, what for you personally was it that made you have this reaction when we asked you about your mates? You light up a little bit because they were so good. What was it? What were they doing to really get around you?
I think they didn't change the way they looked at me. We still reacted the same way. They still tackle me. They still like chuck me out of my chair sometimes. They still I think a lot of people like lost confidence when talking to me and when like, I don't know, when hanging out, but a lot of my mates just acted like nothing changed pretty much. And when they acted like nothing changed, it felt like I was still normal or able, which made it so much easier for me. And we're just having a blast.
That's really important because some people don't know what to do. So what do they do? Nothing.
Nothing, yeah. Minus the part tackling your mates out of it. They tackle you. Angus, don't tackle me.
Okay. Right? I thought you'd give me the green light there to just do the old.
My arms are worth cash to me. I don't want to break any.
All right. I'm just going to give you the edge spear.
Yeah,
WWE reference for people.
Hey, your Instagram is ifightyoufight, at ifightyoufight. Tell me what that means.
So this happened after my injury as well. So I was in ICU and it was probably like the third or fourth day and I was lying there just staring at the roof. And Zach, well, my whole family was with me. Oh, it might have just been my brother, Zach, who's...
That's my brother's name.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, so he's 21. And when I got injured, he was going through HSC. And he was really struggling with, like, just not trying anymore because he couldn't focus and he didn't want to do his exams. And then I was just kind of lying there. And I just said, Zach, if I fight, you fight. And then from there, I've just been fighting, like, just training as hard as I can. And he kind of reacted, and then I've been fighting, and then the whole community around me, my family and friends, they help me so much and support me. So it's kind of like an interrelationship. We both, I fight, they fight, and they fight, I fight, kind of thing, you know?
It's your own battle, your own personal fight.
What do you want this to be? It's got mad foundation charity vibes about it, which I like. Like it rolls off the tongue. Like it's a community thing. What was the response from people when you tell that story?
I think they agree with it because that's how they feel as well. It's literally like a relationship.
And what do you have any ideas of what you want to build it into?
Yeah, so we've been trying to build it. Definitely build it as in an awareness site, like awareness for disabilities, awareness for other things that I can, I don't know, promote, but also like a business tool to try and like link up with companies, brands, people. And hopefully in the future start like maybe a charity or give up some time. But yeah, we're working on developing that at the moment. And
I like where he's at. Business, cash first, charity.
Business, cash, helping other people, mate.
Get on your man. I like that. No, because there's an element of this, right? And this is massive in the disability is people always go, oh yeah, great little cute disabled Instagram. You know, it's so nice and awareness and it's like come into our business and talk for free. It's like, no, if Alex is going to go in there and share his story about how, you know, and really help organizations, well, then the dude should get paid for it because of the good stuff.
No, I totally get it.
10 grand minimum.
Absolutely. Well, it's like, I understand there's a guy called Mike Rolls. I'm sure you probably are familiar with who he is, Alex, but he's this, you know, ridiculous, enduro athlete who does Instagrams with inspirational running, you know, while he's running, does inspirational chats. And yeah, if you're going to take him into your business, you'd have to pay him a mozza for it. So why would it be any different? I understand it. Don't get me wrong. Speaking of your athleticism and your desire and your will to compete, what do you want to do? You're off the drink most of the time. You know,
did you do Paralympics, man?
I'm not big into the wheelchair sports. Like I tried wheelchair rugby and I just hated it.
Why?
I sucked and it was just so different to normal footy. And Yeah, but I think my competition is through academics now and business. So I've shifted my competitive side from physical sport to I don't know, business.
What kind of business? What do you want to do?
I'm doing business law, but that's not because I want... I don't know if I want to be a lawyer or not, but I felt like if I did business and law, everyone needs business and law, so...
Are you the kind of guy who watches a Gary Vee video in the morning?
No. I listen to podcasts, like business podcasts.
And there you go.
What's your favorite podcast? ListenABLE. That's nice, bro.
Listen, yeah, after ListenABLE, I love a bit of Joe Rogan.
Joe.
But then I've also been listening to like these equity mates who just talk about investing and stuff. I've been onto those two at the moment.
Hey, are you, obviously the accident changed your life. Are you a better kid after, a better person after the accident or before? How have you changed?
Definitely after. You can ask my mum.
What does she say? What does she say about it?
Well, my family, like I was definitely an arrogant kid before my accident. I just thought life resolved around me and I thought I was better than everyone else. But now, like my perception on the world has changed so much and now I think I'm a pretty good bloke, I think.
It's pretty funny. It's funny how that happens. You got a shock class in it because it does happen to everyone, I think. You look back on the person you were and you're, you know, younger days. For me, it's looking back on Facebook memories when they go 10 years ago and it's got a status of me going, you know, got Kings of Leon tickets in Brisbane. Any single ladies want to come chill or something stupid? I'm like, who is this guy?
That is the best status I've ever heard.
Literally one was, but it was like, no, single ladies only apply is what I wrote. Anybody
want to get some sex on fire?
But anyway, I can understand you kind of look back on the person I was in my 20s. I'm a bit embarrassed by who that person was because now, you know, I've got a young child. I'm a bit more compassionate, family orientated. I think you just kind of got maybe a shock class in it, do you think?
Yeah, I think it's like I grew a skill of reading the world way better and like different point of view. I literally just view the world so differently now. Like I was never grateful for anything. I just thought, I didn't realize how blessed I was. Like if I was to go back now with the mentality I have now, I'd be like the happiest man in the world. But
are you still blessed though? Even though you decided?
Oh yeah, bloody earth.
Yeah. Why do you say that?
Because I have so like, I can tell you all the things I'm grateful for and
do it.
Why I'm blessed. You want me to do it?
Yeah.
How long does this thing go for?
Give us a few.
What are the big things? What's the head the changes?
What are you?
Well, definitely the main ones would just be family and friends, just being there for me through thick and thin. And I can tell them anything, they'll do anything for me. Just the love surrounding me. The house I live in, we're able to get a house that's flat, put a lift in so I can go up and down.
You got a new house with an elevator or they put an elevator in your existing house?
We sold our old house, which is across the road, and bought this house on the other side of the road. And then NDIS helped us put a lift in. Yeah.
Great.
That's huge.
That's good.
Awesome. Massive. Yeah. And the suburb we live in, there's nothing going on outside. There's no natural disasters. There's no conflict to an extent.
I love it, AJ. It's like you would never have thought of those things, would you?
I don't know those things. Yeah.
And you don't. Yeah.
No.
But it changes your mindset when you're. Not only have a trauma, but when your life changes, you know?
So you did say, though, if you could take this mindset and go back to the day, you know, the Saturday before you played footy, that would be, you know, amazing. Does that mean that, you know, as grateful as you are for the situation and the mindset you have, you do wish away your disability if you had the opportunity?
Well, if I could take my mentality with me right now, yes. But if I went back into my old body, I wouldn't go back, I don't think. Because I was my mindset was just like, I didn't realize, I didn't really have much empathy for people and stuff like that.
Mm.
But yeah, if I could take my mentality right now and into my old body, then bloody oath, I'd do that.
Impressive though, bro. You got 2 years post-accident. You're only 18 years old. You sound about 28 years old. Mm. And for you to already think that is very, very, very impressive, man. I hope you realize that because that takes people with disability able-bodied people who aren't happy with their lives forever. Everybody always wants the grass is greener option. So mature, impressive answer by you.
Mm.
Thank you.
What do you see? So obviously business aside.
I got to ask this business, but you are a good looking rooster as well. Yeah.
Wait, well, like I have a hat on. My hair's not popping off.
Give us a look. Can you take the hat off?
No, I could, but no. Nah, it's terrible.
Use your disability, so you can't.
I can't reach my head.
Did you find it tough going from, you know, what would probably, you know, on the outside you could describe as, you know, the good-looking jock who played sport and was incredibly skilled and was destined for great things within, you know, rugby, and probably did quite well with ladies. Did you are you still around 2 years down the track, you know, relationships with females and being comfortable within your own body to express yourself romantically?
Oh, it's definitely much harder now, and yeah, definitely much harder, but I still try and have a crack.
You should see obviously the little smile on your face, man, when you say that. Funny. But mate, you are, and I'm not, we're not just being dickheads. You are a good looking unit. Are you finding that confidence is coming back slowly?
Oh, I'm definitely less confident than before, just because I know from like the girls' point of view, it'd be so much harder and difficult for them. So
I mean, would it? I mean, I'm dating a sexologist.
And she's, yeah, I know, but not like there's a lot of girls that are just.
It's true. Everyone looks at Manchin Till and thinks he would be no good, or what's going on there. So
I think that.
Yeah, see, and it's fair enough. I mean, so there is an element, and I'm here to dispel that rumor for you personally, you know, because everybody can have sex in any way they can have sex, you know, and you might think people would want it the way Angus does it, but you'd be surprised as long as you can feel confident that
you don't want it the way I do it, man.
Mate, you made a baby. You must be doing something right. Yeah. Isn't that how it works?
Terrible. One of the most boring 4 minutes of ever.
So how do you reckon, what do you reckon is the plan? Are you still like going to get back into dating pretty soon, or are you just going to take it by you?
Yeah, I think I'd definitely like to get a girlfriend right now. Yep.
Mate, this is a great platform to put that out in the world. You know what I mean?
Yeah, hopefully ladies listen to me.
This podcast did actually contribute some love, actually. Our good friend Heath Davidson had someone listen, and then they DM'd him, and then now he's been saying something.
No way.
Oh, really?
There you go.
That is an update.
Yeah. Might have to read my DMs more.
Yeah, get in the friend request.
I fight, you fight. There you go, baby.
But with dating, though, this is a question that I probably had as a bowl of uncomfortable, but I do it. There is one other one that's got sent in. Now knowing what life is like in a chair, life with a disability, do you think if you educated yourself as an able-bodied person, you would be willing to date somebody with a disability if you were able-bodied?
If I had a connection and they made me feel like, obviously, if I felt like there was love there and I felt a good connection and I could relate with that person and they made me a better person, 100%.
Mm. Do you think the old Alex before the accident would have given time to somebody with a disability?
Oh, I'd definitely given time to them, 100%.
Nice.
Yeah. But I didn't really have any interaction, to be honest, with anyone with a disability.
You didn't know anybody with a disability pre-accident?
Oh, my auntie was in a wheelchair for a bit because she had diabetes, but that was it.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, what did you know about disability?
Oh, nothing. Mm. So that makes me think, like, to some people, like, about some people, how they would have no idea either. And I get that, like, with some comments on my Instagram and TikToks or whatever, and then they're just such, like, not stupid questions, but I just realized that some people just know nothing about disabilities.
They're not stupid. The best description I get them to, they're basic questions. You know what I mean? You're like, oh,
yeah. Yeah, really?
Is that all you think? You know what I mean? Yeah. And that's not their fault. It's just because they're not exposed. And that's why everybody needs to listen to ListenABLE podcast.
Well, that's the thing. If someone's already taken the step to listen to this podcast, and they're probably already in the mindset to be welcoming to the idea of learning, where I think a majority of people just ignorantly aren't. And that's not their fault.
That it's got no resources.
It's just not there because they've got nobody. Until you're directly affected by disability, I don't think people really, and quote unquote, care so much about it because it doesn't interact, you know.
Yeah. I agree.
Affect their life in some way. That's how I think about it, I guess. So apart from the business side of things, what do you see for your future personally? Do you want to ever move out? Do you want this independence that you talk about? What do you see for yourself in the future, Alex?
I think my ideal future would be move out, get a hot missus or just a missus, that and maybe and a family, go to work, leave the house to go to work, maybe an office job or whatever, in the morning, come home, night, larvo, and hang with my family in the mornings and nights and the weekends, just like normal people. But yeah, the main thing is just getting a job, like a good job that I love, that I'm good at, and that I can dedicate myself to and compete in. That's where my competition comes in. And then after work, just spend time with my family. That's in the long future though. But in like the short-term future, just do the best I can at uni, get the best possible job I can get. Yeah.
It's very funny chatting to you, Alex, because you do speak so well and you do speak well beyond your years.
And then the most 18-year-old answer.
I get a tiny reminder, you're 18. I want a missus. Hot missus.
I was about to say the same thing. I was about to say the most 18-year-old start to that answer ever.
Yeah. And you get away I'm talking with about business acumen. You know, I'm looking at analytics. I want to get a really independent hot missus. I love it, man. That's funny. Hey, you got to shoot for the stars. I love it. You know what?
Hey, you have no problem getting a job. Like, I hope you don't. Like, obviously, that's why I try and do what I do to change that discrimination in the workplace. But, mate, you keep studying because you're going to have no dramas the way that you communicate.
Thank you.
And speaking of studying, obviously, your accident happened when you were 16 years old, right in the middle of HSC, or what do you call it? ATAR?
ATAR these days. HSC,
ATAR these days. You went back to school. How quickly did you return to school post-accident?
Pretty quickly, because my mum, she pushed it right from the start. Hmm. I thought she was psycho at the beginning, but I'm very thankful now that she did. So I think I got injured in October 2018, and then I was back at school in 2019 part-time. And I think by the end of 2019, I was back doing six periods a day.
Good. Good on you.
Really impressive.
It's crazy. Yeah. It is interesting how, like, some people would – disability. It's like Ben Pettengill, one of our first episodes.
He went back the next day, wasn't it?
Well, he fell asleep, woke up the next morning and he was blind. He could see the night before the next day, and then he's like 2 weeks later.
He's at school on the Monday after, yeah.
We were like, what? But he goes, it just made him feel normal, which is the same for you, you know, to contribute, yeah.
Can you remember the first day you went through the school gates for the first time, and was there anything that felt different or anything you noticed? Did you notice any accessibility problems that obviously you wouldn't have noticed as an able-bodied person?
No, my school was actually very good. Like, the only place in the whole school that I couldn't get to was where me and my mates hang out.
Oh, no way.
No.
Literally. There's like two lifts that get you to every level. You can go to every single spot in the school except...
Well, where are you guys hanging out? Throwing rocks off the roof?
Yeah, so you're on the roof or something?
No, we're on the roof. No. It was just like these two little steps to get up. So we just chucked a little emergency ramp down. Okay. Like, you know, those, just like a portable ramp. And
yeah, the ones you get on, like, when there's roadworks on the side, like, to get up the curbs.
Oh, yeah. Or the cables.
Yeah. Yeah, just like one of those. But the first day back to school, I was definitely weird, and I was definitely nervous and scared because I thought everyone's going to, like, be looking at me. I talked to so many people that day. That's the most people I've talked to in my life, I think.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I just thought it'd be so different. But everyone was so good, like, the community just treated me as normal, and then it was pretty easy to get back into after that.
Great to hear, man. It's time for our bowl of uncomfortable. Now, this is, I'm not sure if you listened. Oh, yes, good. That means you have listened. It's a question that gets sent in to us by somebody who is listening to the podcast. They have a question maybe specifically or general about disability. Yours is semi-specific. It's not necessarily directed towards you, but it's directed, I've had it in the bank, for someone who is quadriplegic. So you fit the bill. What was and what may still be the hardest physical difference going from being able-bodied to quadriplegic?
Physical difference. I think the main thing would be hand function.
Really?
Hand function, yeah. If I could bring back my legs or my hands, if I only had one option, it would be my hands.
Okay, because you have movement in your arms, but what you
know, I have biceps, but nothing else. I've just like a bit of shoulders and biceps, but
you can't move your fingers.
I can't. Well, pretty much no. Like, I can twitch them a little bit. No hand function. I can't grasp anything. I'd have no wrists either. So yeah, just like picking up like these cashews next to me. So to pick them up, I'll be battling.
Really?
Yeah.
I think that, yeah, it's a bummer you lose your triceps before biceps, because you actually, biceps don't really do much, but triceps means you can transfer, like do a dip to get from one seat to another. So they're really important, and obviously hands. So I can see where, I am lucky that I've, you know, good use of my hands. One of them's a bit stuffed up from that accident, but you know, I don't miss my legs at all. You know, I think legs are overrated.
Can I ask a really personal question, Alex? And you don't have to necessarily answer this, and we can edit it out. Don't worry. When I was 18 years old, I was very unlucky in love, and I would have to do that for myself a lot. How do you go with having young man's urges and not necessarily being able to do anything about it?
Well, I can, in bed, I can do it. Or kind of, like, I can't grasp, but lucky enough, my fingers kind of curl up a little bit. So it's kind of like a grasping motion, but yeah, I can do it a little bit, but I can't finish, I don't think.
Yeah.
But apparently you can with some device, but I don't have the device, but yeah, so I can kind of with an extent to it, but yeah, it's not as good as before, obviously, but so it does a job.
Yeah, you can get like these like vibrating things that help you ejaculate when you're a para or quadriplegic. I think that's what Alex is talking about. Or you can get someone to help you at iFight, you fight.
Jesus. Still, that is the most worst DM slide ever.
I don't get, no, like, you know, come in the bed.
Biggest wingman ever.
Well, if you know about.
I'm wingman and my boy, all right?
If you know that much about it, then do you know if you talked about a family down the track? That is something that you can have. Did you ask the doctors if it's a future for me?
Yeah, well, most quads and paras still can, or pretty like 90% of them can, 95. But I haven't got it checked or anything, but I would get it checked.
Yeah, you can always.
If I had a missus, that would happen.
Yeah, but I thought because, you know, that you talk about using it or losing it, and it's like, does that just go away? Like,
No, it stays.
So you still keep producing. Yeah, there you go. I guess that's more of a biological question than it is a disability.
That's a good,
question.
Well, uncomfortable question. That was a really good chat. I like that a lot.
Thanks very much for coming onto our show. We really do appreciate it. And you actually were nominated 4 or 5 times from people that, one person who went to one of your talks, the one that you have photos of on your website, very flashy website, by the way. And 3 people who follow you on Instagram. So they wanted us to, there wasn't us. And the funny thing was, they weren't, you should chat to. It's like, you must.
Yeah, yeah.
He's we're doing you a favor. Chat to Alex Noble.
We've obviously talked to you for about 40 minutes. And obviously you're getting heaps of texts. Because you're just getting some text over here on the side. Who's dropping? You're just looking down on your phone.
Oh, right? Yeah.
Am I making that up?
Yeah, no, I was getting the
comments. Dylan's pretending that your DMs are already on fire.
Yeah, your DMs going up already.
Yeah, the episode's not even live. Bunch of fitties are texting me. Far out.
Alex Noble, thank you so much. I Fight, You Fight on Instagram, as if we needed to plug it again. If you want to get in contact with Alex, go through his Instagram, and he's very, very flashy, great website, mate.
Get on your
bras,
keep dominant, and keep your
mind. Thank you so much.
Very impressive.
Will do. Thanks, guys.
Thanks,